Good evening. I have the pleasure to start this academic year, our seminar cycle. And today we have the speaker. I think I don't need introduce, but I just want to say that Andrzej is almost all career connected with the Observatory. He was the also former director of the Observatory. He has a short break on the postdoc in York University in Toronto, in Canada. And then he back here and start the OCL project. And today he will talk how we back after the pandemic break.
Thank you so much, Mario, for the introduction. Okay, it's always a great pleasure to start the new academic year. Tuesday seminars here. This academic year is 2022 to 2023, and I usually had a short report on the OGL achievements, OGL developments in the first seminar. So today, this is similar situation. I would like to tell you a few words about what is going on with the OGL project. And the title of my talk is OGL is back. And as you will see in a moment, OGL is indeed back in operation after a very hard, almost 3 years break. First of all, I show you a few slides to remind you what the OGL project is. And a few nice images so you know where you observe and what are our observing facilities. The OGL abbreviation stands for the Optical Gravitational Lens Experiment. This is one of the oldest astronomical projects, likely the only one from the first generation large scale sky surveys. And it started 30 years ago in 1992. And generally we divide our history in phases which are related with our observing capabilities. These phases are marked with the Roman number after the name. So we started with OGL 1 in the 90s, then switched to OGL 2 when we built a new telescope at our observing site at Las Campanas in Chile. Then at the beginning of this century, this millennium, we started OGL 3 phase. And finally, 12 years ago, we started the last phase of the OGL project, OGL 4, which very likely will be finished this year. And next year, I hope we will begin the next step in our history, probably OGL 5. But it's not clear at this moment. In which phase after each phase, we increase our observing capabilities, so you can see how many objects we observe, 2 million in OGL 1 up to more than 2 billion in the last OGL 4 phase. Here is a very well known picture of our observing site. This is Las Campanas Observatory. Our 1.3 meter telescope, the dome, and the control room. One more picture, the nice picture of our telescope in the dome, and the telescope itself. So this is 1.3 meter telescope dedicated for photometry and for large photometric survey. It is dedicated for observing as many objects as possible, and in different phases, instruments allowed to observe well from this 2 million, from 30 million in OGL 2, because we use these telescopes since Ogle 2 phase, and now during Ogle 4, as I mentioned, we observe over the two billion stars. Here is the main instrument of Ogle 4, the MOSAIC CCD camera. It consists of 32 individual chips. It covers a large area in the sky. This is the typical image toward the galactic center. Very dense field, so in one exposure we have in this direction about 6 million stars, and the field of view of this camera is actually, this camera fills almost an entire field of view of our telescope. So this is 1.4 square degree. This is about 7 moon disks. So you can imagine how big is one image. And the resolution is also very fine. The pixel size is 15 microns, and the scale in the telescope is quarter of arc second. This is because the seeing and atmospheric conditions and last campanas are excellent, one of the best in the world. So we have to be well suited for this very good astronomical sight, and so that such a resolution allows us to achieve very, very precise photometry, which reaches mini magnitude accuracy and is likely the best which we can achieve from the ground. So this is close to the limits. Ogle 4 started in 2010. The first light of this instrumental setup was taken in September 2009, but the regular observation started in March 2010, so more than 12 years ago. Ogle project targets are usually related to very dense stellar fields. This is a typical field in the galactic center. So, as I showed you before, the 6 million stars in one image, and this is a close-up, so you can see that stars are everywhere in such images. And this is the Ogle sky, which we observed up to early 2020. So this is entire sky, which is seen from Las Campanas, and we concentrated on the densest parts of the sky. So our priority was the galactic belt and Magellanic clouds, and then we extended our survey to the galactic disk and covered practically entire galactic disk, which is seen from Las Campanas. And then in March 2020, as we all know, a disaster occurred in the world. COVID pandemic started, and the world was completely panicked because of this. And of course, this affected very strongly also astronomy. The pandemic started in February and quickly developed in March 2020. And of course, it also affected Chile, and the infection number developed, increased very rapidly there. So the main astronomical observatories started to be limited observations, and most of them were completely closed. And on March 16, 2020, director of Las Campanas decided to close the entire observatory. We are part of the Las Campanas observatory, so we had to close our facilities as well. He decided to leave only the very small crew on the mountain. All telescopes were supposed to be closed, and instruments warmed up or turned off. Initially, this closure was planned for just 2 weeks, so we hope that this closure will be this break in our observations will be just for a short period of time. But that was just our hope. In the real life, this closure was extended for months, and Las Campanas Observatory was closed for at least 1 year. Right after this decision on March 16, we had to close our telescope. On March 17, the last night was from the 16 to 17, and then we had to organize evacuation of our last observer, who was Patrick Ivanek, and this was a real challenge because, well, international connections were very limited at that time, and fortunately, he managed to get to US, and then he caught the last rescue flight from New York to Poland. So he's safely arrived in Poland around March 20. But the telescope was left. And this is the last picture of our telescope just before the full turn off, and in the morning of March 17. So, as I mentioned, we hope that after 1, 2, 3 months, we will be able to get back to Las Campanas. Unfortunately, this break extended to mid 2022. Las Campanas developed some pandemic rules, and for several months in 2020 and 2021, all telescopes on the mountain were closed, including this big Magellan telescopes there. But when the pandemic was a little bit milder, they decided to reopen the largest telescope with limited crew on the mountain. So the observations, the first observations were made only in remote mode. And there was no access to smaller telescopes on the mountain. So even if we were really brave to go to Chile, down to Chile, we couldn't get to the mountain because we wouldn't have access to the observatory. The second reason of this long break was, of course, general world problems with flights, with international and with intercontinental flights, which were practically stopped in March 2020, and then gradually resumed, but still the frequency of flights to Chile was very, very limited in 2021. Besides that, Chile started very severe restrictions on coming to Chile, and simply practically closed borders for foreigners. Only residents were allowed to enter Chile in 2021, and practically to April of 2022, Chile was not accessible for foreigners, so it was not possible to get there. The situations improved a little bit in spring this year. In April, Chilean government eased somewhat restrictions, and it started to be possible to get to the country under some still quite severe conditions with special documents. Also, Las Campanas Observatory a little bit eased their rules, and they allowed visitors to enter observatory, but again with some strict conditions related with COVID pandemic and things related to COVID. So in June this year, June, July, we our group started planning a rescue mission to our telescope, to our observing site at Las Campanas. The main goal was, of course, to restart the OGLE observations, but to see our facilities and check on place if everything survived or not this 2.5 year break. So we decided to go to Chile. We had to fulfill the Chilean restrictions, so we had to prepare a necessary set of documents. For example, we had to obtain from Chilean Health Ministry so-called Pase de Movilidad, such documents which allowed us to enter Chile practically, because without this Pase de Movilidad, it wouldn't be possible to get the local transport, local flights, wouldn't be possible to get to restaurants, to any public places. The second document was so-called C-19 form, which was a document where we had to specify what will be, where will we have a quarantine if we get COVID. But it was also possible to obtain this document, so we got it. And of course, the next nice thing was a set of COVID tests, the first one at arrival. When we arrived, it was passengers were randomly selected for such COVID tests at the border. And one of us was randomly selected, of course. Okay, the next set of restrictions was on the mountain. And these restrictions were included the special transportation from the airport in La Serena to the observatory, and then 3 days of isolation, strict isolation, so no contact with local personnel. So we had to be in lodging in the hotel in separate rooms. Fortunately, we could meet each other within our rescue mission, because we were together. In any case, we were together, so we couldn't contact with Las Campanas personnel for 3 days. But this wouldn't affect us that much, because we could go to the telescope and check what's going on there. Then we had to pass 3 COVID tests, first at the arrival, the second after 3 days of this quarantine, and the last one after 10 days. So we were tested very, very, very precisely on the mountain. And finally, one more obstacle not related to COVID. Just 1 week before our planned arrival, a heavy storm, heavy snowstorm occurred at Las Campanas. Well, this is not surprising. This is the winter time at Las Campanas, so storms are, I wouldn't say common, but happen. This one was severe, and it damaged a lot of things in observatory. And practically paralyzed observatory for a couple of days, so we're not sure if we can go to the observatory. Fortunately, the situation has improved, and we obtained green light for our trip. And on July 27th, 2022, our rescue team, which included Janek Skowron, Michał Szymański, and me, we started our mission and boarded at Okęcie Air France flight, first to Paris, from Paris to Santiago, 14 hours flight. And very exhausted, we arrived at Santiago Airport. We passed this first control. As I mentioned, one of us, Janek, was tested as randomly selected passenger. Pass control was typical, custom control was typical. And finally, we could travel to La Serena. And now I show you a few photographs from our mission, just to show you what we saw when we arrived. So first picture is from the Santiago airport, where we arrived after a long, long trip. We took the vaccination here, as you see, the booster, which fortunately was very, very tasty and nice, and we survived thanks to that. The same day we arrived on Las Campanas, at the mountain, and our first steps were toward our observing facilities. This is our first look at the telescope and control room. We are very fortunate and very happy to see that everything is here. Well, didn't know what is inside, but from outside looks quite okay. So first we went to the control room, which was not easy because the lock was in bad shape, I would say. It was stuck, so we had to go through the window inside. And what we saw there, it was exactly the configuration that our last observer left on March 17, 2020. So the notes on the desk and other things were almost exactly like on March 17, 2020. Everything was covered with some layer of dust, of course, because there was no cleaning in this room. And on the wall, we noticed the calendar with 2020 January up to March. Well, 12th of March was the last date, but actually Patrick left on March 17th. Then we went to the telescope, and well, slowly opens the door. It was like opening a Tutankhamun tomb, so nobody knew what is inside, but fortunately everything was almost exactly in the same shape as Patrick left. So the telescope was...
Andre, when you open a tomb, you have always, movies you can see, there are always plenty of spider webs.
A spider? No. We did not this web. But everything was covered with very thick layer of dust. So that was the only new thing inside the dome, inside on the ground floor of the telescope. But well, everything looked quite nice. To our surprise, we found that close to our Casa Polaca, where we sleep, there is a big construction place, and new installations are built just very close to us. And this awful building was built also very close to us. A lot of constructions around our dome, so it was quite dangerous to get to our Casa Polaca, and we didn't know about this new developments around our no, as I mentioned, 1 week earlier, Las Campanas had a big snowstorm, so snow was everywhere. And it was, well, the weather was much better than a week earlier, but we still had a lot of snow around. And this is one more photo of the rescue team. As I mentioned, we were tested 3 times and we passed the tests, just one bar, as you can see. So we could start our rescue mission. And for the first days, these were our main tools to clean everything. And indeed, it was very, very hard work. Fortunately, the hardware was practically in good shape. Well, when we cleaned different parts of our building, of our casa control, of the dome, we always found some fossils of insects. And this is one nice example. This is not a constellation, but a real Scorpius. The telescope was also in quite good shape. However, we had to check every part, lubricate a lot of important crucial places. Of course, clean it very carefully because, as I mentioned, the dust layer was quite high. And finally, we decided to open the mirror. The mirror was still there. And as you can see, it's not in perfect shape. It was reflectivity after this 2.5 years was lower than in 2020, but not that much. So because we knew that we cannot re-aluminize the mirror during this mission, because first of all, this was a winter time, and then we had to get access to Las Campanas observatory facilities, aluminization facilities. So we decided to just clean the mirror a little bit, but we left it in this shape as it is now. Actually, our observations show that the drop of sensitivity is not that big, so the telescope can still be used for the next couple of months. Another example of cleaning, so this is the cleaning of the dome and lubricating of the dome. And finally, after 3 or 4 days of this cleaning and everything was checked, we started turning on our instrument, main instrument camera. These are compressors which provide cooling gas to our camera. So the historic moment of turning on these compressors. There were some minor problems, but we managed to fix them, and the camera reached the low temperature at which it operates. So at the beginning of August, on, as I remember, 2nd or 3rd August, we were able to take the first images and check all our instruments. And the telescope was still not in optimal shape, but the first images were taken, and we more or less knew what to do during the next days. Of course, as usual at Las Campanas, we had visitors, so a lot of condors sometimes. So they were quite close to us, so we could make a lot of nice photographs. Donkeys were also there, and they often come very early in the morning, so are not very welcome, especially when observers are sleeping. So our rescue mission was quite successful. The first technical images were taken at the beginning of August. After that, we still had a lot of work with the telescope, collimation of the telescope. And finally, we restarted regular observing on August 12th this year. And the telescope was in pretty good shape. The images were nice. And this is one of the examples of one of the images taken toward the galactic center. And as of today, our statistics look like you can see here. So right now, Radek Poleski is there, Las Campanas, and this is the fourth observing run. Next are already planned, and we'll certainly observe continuously to the end of this year and in the next spring. Up to now, more than 13,000 images were collected. Online reductions were started. So practically the telescope is in full operation and the rescue mission was a full success. We are back in business. What more, we have already made some contribution to the science. In the mid of September, NOVA in the in constellation Mensa, quite close to the Large Magellanic Cloud, erupted, and Radek Poleski checked our images of this field and found that we have that the NOVA is in our fields, and it turned out that this first detection of our of this NOVA in our images was the earliest detection of this object in the world. So we sent the information to the ATEL astronomical telegrams informing about our discovery. This field is not observed very often, so every week at this moment, so we don't have a better cadence light curve, but we will observe the fall of this. Right now, probably the NOVA is still saturated in our images, but then it will go down and so we'll have a nice light curve of this object. So we are also back in science. Okay, so I could stop here because well, the topic was Ogle is back, and as you can see, Ogle is back in business indeed. But in the second part of my talk, I would like to show you some highlights from the Ogle during the last 3 years. Well, we didn't have fresh blood in the form of new observations, but we have a big databases of our photometric data from 25 years. So I would like to show you our main results during the last 3 years. Not all, of course, because the number of papers from Ogle was very, very large in this period, and just the main topics. Okay, so first I would like to show you picture related to our anniversary. Our first images were taken, our first Ogle images were taken in 1992. On April 12th, and this is a symbolic date of the start of our project. Those are the first images taken exactly on this first night. Maybe not the first ones, but one from the galactic extragalactic field, and one from the galactic belt. And as you probably remember, in 2017 we had silver anniversary, so 25 years of the OGL project, and we organized a conference here in Warsaw. This is a poster from this conference and a picture of the OGL team at that time. This year we have 2022, so it's easy to notice that this year we had 30th anniversary of the OGL project. Because in April we were in pretty bad shape with our telescope and generally not in good mood to celebrate this anniversary, so we had a very very small celebration, and this is a picture of our OGL team here in our observatory, taken exactly on April 12, 2022. Okay, now the science. So as usual, we did a lot of contributions in exoplanets field. We participated in several dozen discoveries of new exoplanets using microlensing technique. The number of microlensing planets in the last 2-3 years was significantly increased thanks to the Korean survey KMTNet, which has three telescopes located in three continents, not only in Chile but also in Australia and in also in South Africa. So the number of exoplanets and planetary anomalies in microlensing events was increased, and we participated also very often in these discoveries. We also participated in several publications related with space microlensing results. Those projects were conducted in the last decade. Spitzer satellite was used, and these campaigns lasted from 2014 to 2019. And Kepler K2C9 project was conducted in 2017. We also contributed. We also had further contributions to the so-called free floating planets, planets which are, as the name suggests, free floating in our galaxy, not related to stars. And also we had contributions related with wide orbit exoplanets. So a few pictures in this topic. So these are typical examples of exoplanet detections of exoplanets. So we have a microlensing light curve with some anomaly here at the maximum, here at the rising branch, even more complicated here. And these are signatures of the second body at the lens. And usually this may be either star, brown dwarf, or a planet. So after modeling, we can conclude if we indeed discovered a new exoplanet. And as I mentioned, we had several such events of this type during the last 3 years. Space microlensing, this is the project which allows to derive the parallax of the so-called microlensing parallax. This is the most precise technique of determination of the microlensing parallax. And when we have a parallax and additional effects from the photometry, we can derive the distance to the exoplanet, the exoplanetary system, and study distribution of exoplanets in our galaxy. We have to observe the same phenomenon, microlensing phenomenon from two places, from two distant places. And in the case of space microlensing, one observer is at Earth, and we have a nice light curve from, for example, Ogul here, and one from the satellite, in this case, Spitzer satellite, which is different than seen from the Earth. And from this difference, we can derive the parallax very precisely. There are also other techniques to derive parallaxes from the Earth, but this is the most precise. So a few papers from this mission, from the second part of this mission, appeared in astronomical journals during the last 3 years, and we contributed to many of them. Three floating planets. These are planets which are not related to stars. They were likely ejected from the planetary systems at the early stages of planetary system formation, or due to passage of stars close to a planetary system. And as you probably remember, we had an opus magnum about the three floating planets by Przemek Brus et al., published in Nature in 2017. And in this paper, we had a very detailed analysis, and it was found that there is no big population of free floating Jupiters, but perhaps there is a quite numerous population of low mass, Earth mass free floating planets. And after this paper, Przemek very extensively looked in our data and found several nice examples, and two more really nice examples were found and published in 2020. The first one is on the left. This is the microlens from 2019. And this is a record holder. This is the shortest time microlensing event. The Einstein time was 0.03 days, so minutes. And of course, we had to sell these results in very reliable way. We had to add observations not only from Ogul, but also from other surveys, from PMT mostly. But it looks like this detections are very, very sound. And indeed, this is the lowest mass free-floating planet. With the mass, we cannot derive precisely the mass of this object, but we can estimate it as with some probability, and with high probability, the mass is lower than the Earth mass. Quite likely that this is something like Mars mass object. What more, this object was very well sold to general public, and in 2020, in December 2020, I don't know exactly who it was, but there was a contest on Twitter called ExoCup 2020, in which a lot of newly discovered planets were fighting for the title of the planet of the year 2020. And our planet, this Ogul 2016, Belgia 1928, went to the main final, and we lost with the white dwarf planet. But the final result was not that close, but well, just as far as I remember, just 2 hours before closing the voting, we were still very close, or even a little bit better than this white dwarf planet. Anyway, the silver medal is also a nice achievement in public. Oh, public. So, One more picture. This is analysis which was led by Radek Poleski. He analyzed white orbit planet exoplanets, which were detected in the OGLE survey. He analyzed 20 years of OGLE data, and the general conclusion was here that ice planets, ice giants like Uranus and Neptune, are quite common. Although the sample of discovered planets is not very, very long, very large, the general simulations show that the number of such planets should be large. When we are at microlensing as the technique for finding exoplanets, a few words on another discovery, our big contribution related with one of the next main microlensing technique goal, namely the determination of the optical depth to microlensing in our Milky Way. This is a very important number for testing the galactic models and testing the galactic structure. And in his PhD paper, Przemek Brus showed the optical depths in this shaded region in the galactic center. But this work was an extension of this work to the galactic disk. And as I said at the beginning of our talk, we observed the galactic disk as one of our targets. And more than 600 microlensing events was found in the galactic disk. And this analysis showed how the optical depth behaves in our galaxy. Here is a galactic center. So here we have a precise maps of the optical depth, and then, as expected, we see that optical depth is lower and lower. These are the less dense parts of our galaxy, and this is the main result of this paper. One more opus magnum, real opus magnum, reddening maps of the toward the Magellanic clouds. The paper by Dorota Skowron, Jasiu Skowron et al. Presents precise determination of the interstellar extinction towards this region of the sky. Actually, the data from OGLE cover this part in this ovals. This is the Large Magellanic Cloud. This is the Small Magellanic Cloud, and the reddening was derived using the red clump stars in the homogeneous environment have well-defined color. So when we compare this intrinsic color with observed color, we have information on the reddening, and these beautiful maps were published and are. These are most precise reddening maps toward these two galaxies, and these two galaxies are the laboratories of astrophysics. So these maps are used for very many projects and purposes, and already these papers were cited more than 50 times. This is still very, very young paper. So this is a real opus magnum, and it will be in use for, I think, for decades. Now a few words about variable stars, which is also one of our main topics. So as you remember, we prepared big collections of different types of variable stars. Igor Soszyński is the leading person in this project. And here is a picture of the distribution of the Ogle Cepheid in the in our galaxy. Here we have a distribution of Aurelia stars in the Ogle sky. And you may also remember that this collection, especially this Cepheid collection, was used for construction of very unique three-dimensional maps of young population in our galaxy. We had a large sample of Cepheids. We could derive precise distances, so we could see not only two-dimensional map on the sky, but also in the third dimension how the Cepheids are distributed. So this is the picture from the top of our galaxy. We could analyze how the disk plane is, what is the form of the disk plane, and we noticed the galactic disk warp, which is clearly seen with our data. We could notice very precisely in the galactic disk flaring, so the disk is much wider, far from the galaxy center. The same set was used by Przemek Mróz for determination of the rotation curve of our Milky Way, together with Gaia measurements of radial velocities. And those two papers on the map and this are really, again, opus magnum for this field. The paper Skovron et al. Paper was already cited over 100 times. This paper is cited almost 80 times. But when we prepared those two papers, we still conducted, after this paper, two papers were ready, we still conducted observations, and we concentrated on the part of the sky close to the limit. This part of the sky is not available, it's not accessible in Chile, but this part was not very well observed. And in 2019, we extended our observations and added more data in this particular directions, and found a significant number of extra Cepheids in this direction, which then was were the base of our extension of our maps. And in this way, we could also show not very well, not the southern warp of our Milky Way, but also this northern part of this warp. In the last 2 years, we extended our list of Cepheids. First of all, Igor carried out independent, deeper search for Cepheids in our Ogle data and found extra classical Cepheids, also anomalous Cepheids and second population Cepheids. So our sample was extended, so increased. On the other hand, Paweł Pietrukowicz prepared and maintains the list of classical Cepheids, not only from Ogle, but from all published surveys. He verified each Cepheid from other surveys, and only the very reliable objects are included in this list. So this is very clean and very reliable list of Cepheids. In the last months, this list was somewhat updated. Gaia DR3 release, so release of Gaia data DR3, also presented the sets of variable stars from this project, which included Cepheids and Aurelias. But they were looked carefully by Igor and Paweł to find if in our sample is indeed complete. And only minor upgrades of of our already known sea phase were found. So, for example, in the Magellanic Clouds, the number of extra sea phase from Gaia DR3 is really just a few. A little bit more in the galactic disk, but it's not surprising we had limited strip of sky which we cover. Also a few papers practically repeating Skovron et al. Analysis and Chamek-Proust analysis of this galactic rotation curve were published, and mostly they were confirming the earlier Auger results. Okay, now the next category of variable stars. This is a well-known period luminosity picture from Igor, showing all types of pulsating stars observed by Auger. We can see very nice period luminosity sequences here. And one of the sequences called LSP. This is a long secondary period stars which are which have short period periodicity, usually from this region, from these objects, and also the long period. This long period is, as you can see, logarithm p is between 2 and 3, so this is hundreds of thousand days. And this period is still a big mystery. What is causing this? This secondary period. As you can see, this sequence is connected with the sequence resulting from eclipsing and ellipsoidal stars. So the one would guess that the LSP phenomenon is also caused by binarity. And indeed, Igor did a very extensive analysis of this type stars. And not only in optical bands, but also in deep infrared bands from WISE satellite, and found that there are clear eclipses and primary and secondary eclipses seen in deep infrared, not seen in optical bands. And he argumented that the reason of this long secondary period is indeed binarity, and the companions are low mass objects like brown dwarfs or planets, exoplanets, and embedded in dust. So that's why these eclipses are only seen in deep infrared. Well, to test this hypothesis, a lot of new observations are necessary, and Dorota Skovron proposed propose a project which the main goal is to shed a new light on this phenomenon, and she was successful and received in 2021 ERC starting grant for studying this type of stars. So hopefully in the next years we'll see a lot of new developments in this category. In this two, three last years, we also released big collections, not only of this main pulsating stars, so Cepheids and Aralyres, but also other type of pulsating stars. So first of all, I would like to mention here Mira's variables. Patrick Ivanek was the leading person here, and this will be the topic of his PhD thesis. So you can see examples of very long coverage of MIRAS distribution, and he also led extensive analysis of period luminosity relations for this type of stars. So this will also be a big contribution to this field. Next big collections are the also pulsating stars, Delta Scuti stars. Paweł Pietrukowicz released a collection of Delta Scuti from the galactic center, from the belt. And then this collection was extended by Igor to the galactic disk. And so this is the really big, big set of very precise astrophysical data. And this will be widely used by different astronomers. I should also mention of one more category of very, very interesting and very nicely looking stars. These are so-called heartbeat stars because they show such nice pulsations, like the pulsations of the electrocardiogram test. So this light curves have a full variety of such pulses, and originally they were, as far as I remember, discovered in the Kepler data, but they are called as heartbeat stars, but they are common in also other type of stars. These are stars on different type of stars on very eccentric orbits, and the light curves where the orbit is very eccentric look not like a typical sinusoid in the case of zero eccentricity, but they have such extra effects. And Marcin Wrona, Milena Ratajczak were the leading people working on this objects, and we released the largest collection of these stars quite recently. Okay, the finally, I would like to mention one of our recent discoveries related with black holes. First of all, the free floating black discovery of the first free floating black hole it was announced in June. This is the name of this object. This was a microlensing technique was used. So this is the event which was found by us, and to analyze this phenomenon, Ogle photometry, ground-based photometry, but mostly Ogle photometry and HST astrometry was used. Two independent teams used the same data and analyzed this phenomenon. As you can see, the results were on one hand quite clear that the lensing object is a black hole, but generally were a little bit disappointing. So this is the image from Ogle data. You can see the typical microlensing event. This is the source, which brightens quite a lot during the phenomenon. Here is the astrometry taken with the HST data during the last decade. There are clear difference in the proper motion compared to the single object proper motion. So the results were, as you can see here, the SAHU team obtained the mass of the lensing object 7.1 solar mass. And the second team obtained a range of possible masses. The most likely mass was from this analysis was 4.4 solar mass, but it was possible that this object has lower mass, around 2 solar mass. So it looked quite clear that this object, because there is no light from this lens, this object must be stellar remnants, very likely a black hole. Perhaps from this analysis, it could also be a neutron star. Generally, these results were a little bit disappointing because the same data set and completely different results, different masses, and in this case, even the different kind of objects would be possible. Neutron stars were not excluded. Przemek, we started thinking that there is some clear systematic effects which can affect the data, analyzed data, because from the same observations to different results were published. First of all, the systematics could be in the Ogle photometry. And the second possibility was that it was in HST astrometry. And here are illustrations. So in the left picture, you can see the microlensing event. These are Ogle data. Well, this is, it's hard to say if there is something, there is some systematic in this picture, but astrometry is shown here. The blue is SAHU astrometry and model, and in the red is LAM analysis and data. And even here by eye, you can see that the measurements are quite different. So certainly there is a systematics in astrometry. It could be clearly seen in this plot, which shows the proper motion. And this is the line of proper motion with errors from the LAM analysis. This is from the SAHU analysis, completely different directions, inclinations. And from photometry, we can also derive this region where we can put the proper motion. And from this original light curve, we see that this Ogle measurements, photometric measurements, show the region in between those two astrometric measurements. So there was a clear tension between photometry and astrometry, and we decided to check our photometry if there is some kind of systematic in the data. Usually Ogle photometry is almost perfect, but in this case we had some we noticed some symptoms that there are some effects related with the seeing. And to try to do better photometry, we decided to reduce our Ogle, all this Ogle data, with different reference image, with much better resolution reference image compared to the standard reference image which we used. And this was a good choice, because it turned out that indeed there is some systematic in Ogle data. After re-reducing, when we received new photometry and repeated modeling, it turned out that the photometry quite well fits the SAHU astrometric reductions. So the situation now is clean. Indeed, we see that SAHU astrometry is close to good. Our photometry is also complement with this astrometry, and this reductions have some systematic effects. And we, of course, our photometry also had originally systematic effects. What was the reason? The reason was simple. The nature is hides discoveries very, very tight way. And in this case, the microlensing occurred very close to very bright stars. So it was very difficult to measure precise position of this lens here with astrometry. SAHU had to develop very special pipeline to do this as precise as possible. The second group very likely did it not that precisely. And this was also the problem with photometry, because in our case, in our Ogle image, both stars are well inside this one PSF. So when the relative brightness changed, also our measurements, when the reference image with moderate seeing was used, had some systematic effects. So our final analysis was already published, and the result is clean. This is really this object is really a free floating black hole with a mass of 7.9 solar mass. And a few days later, we had one more contribution, this time to the in the same field, this time to the so-called dormant black hole. So dormant black holes are black holes in binary systems. If one of the components is a black hole, we typically have transfer of mass in such system, and we see its effects in the X-rays, and such system are high mass X-ray binaries or low mass X-ray binaries. On the other hand, people expected that there should be a population of so-called dormant black holes, so also binary systems with the black hole, but wide enough or systems where there is no transfer of mass, so there is no X-rays or any other activity, and only precise measurements from spectroscopy can show that the companion is indeed a black hole. Several such announcements were published last year, but most of them, practically all of them, were short-lived. Follow-up observations or follow-up analysis showed that the proposed cases are not the systems which include black hole. But in our case, we hope and we are almost sure that this system is indeed example of such dormant black hole. This is a system in LMC, in Tarantula Nebula. Right now it's just one of the two reliable cases, and here is the artist's impression how such system could look like. Okay, so I'm finishing, and now just a few words about PR. So during the last 3 years, we had a good opportunity to increase our PR. Ogle discoveries were presented at Expo exhibition in Dubai, Expo 2020, but this exhibition was started last year in October 21 and lasted to March 22. So as you can see in this photographs, there were this exposition, there were installations which showed the Ogle discoveries.
Why they didn't use the Arabic letters for Ogle?
I don't know. They could probably. The number of visitors there was around 1 million, so at least 1 million could see Ogle there. During this last 3 years, we received quite a few prestigious awards. Here is a list. So starting from International Astronomical Union awards for Przemek Brus for the best PhD thesis, and then Frank Wilczek Award. This is the award. Frank Wilczek is a Nobel laureate in physics, and he founded a new kind of quite prestigious award, which is maintained by Jagiellonian University. We received the Ogle team the award of the Prime Minister of Republic of Poland. A few other awards from Polish Academy of Arts and Sciences, from Polish Academy of Sciences. I received an award from Chilean government, founded to celebrate 500 years of the Magellan Strait discovery by Magellan. As I mentioned, Dorota Skowron was awarded the ERC grants 2021. And also there was a bunch of our degrees and titles, PhD degrees and habilitation thesis and professor titles related for people only related. Okay, and finally, two words about our new strategies for this decade. Well, this is a kind of new period in the Ogle history, so we probably will change a little bit our observing strategy. Especially in the Belch, we will change our cadence of observations. During the last decade, we observed very, very high cadence central parts of the galactic belt, mostly were focused on exoplanets and free floating planets. Now we will be in the galactic belt, very likely focused on longer time events. So we want to observe practically all belt fields where microlensing events are detected, much larger area at the cost of lower cadence. We hope to find a large number of long period events, which are very good candidates for lensing with stellar remnants like neutron stars or black holes. Similar change already occurred in the Magellanic clouds. In this case, for years we observed Magellanic clouds with very relatively low cadence of 1 to 3 days each field. And right now we want to observe the most dense fields with very high cadence of minute cadence, and we'll see what new we can get from observations of this in this very short time scale in both large and small Magellanic clouds. So I stop here, and it's a well-known poster summarizing Ogle achievements in the last decade. Thank you very much.
Okay, time to for question. We start with question from audience, and then we will check what people from internet would like to know. Okay, any question? Yes, please.
You mentioned the next phase of the Ogle project.
Maybe we repeat the question because the people don't see. Uh-huh. This is the question about the next phase of the Ogle and what we do.
Well, I'm not sure if we change the number. This time we don't have opportunity to increase significantly our observing capabilities because, as I mentioned, our mosaic camera fills the entire field of view. So we changed the strategy, what I mentioned a while ago. And this new strategy will probably be related with different phase. So we will call it probably Ogle 5, but it will not mean that new telescope or new camera, but rather new observing strategy.
More question? Okay, I don't see it.
Radek.
Hi, I would like to add that the last night was very clear and observations were very good. No question.
Thank you.
Thank you, Radek. Just for the audience, Radek said that the last night was clear and observations are good.
So we are back in business.
So I don't see more questions. So let's thank Andrzej again.
Thank you.
So this semester we concentrate on the dense object and compact object, and next up will be Dominika Krul from Jagiellonian University, and he talks about the Michael Lansing event in ATNs. Thank you very much. See you next week. Thank you.